That's how you change the world.
Thank you for listening to Change the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Somerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, with today's message, here's Pastor Vic.
Lord, we do bless your name this morning. We magnify and lift your name up to be worshiped this morning, God. We thank you for the power of the cross, the power of the blood of Jesus that has reconciled us, sinful men and women, unto you, a holy God. We thank you for the power of your word. And as we open up your word today, God, I pray that your anointing and your truth would fall upon us, Lord, that you would help us to understand. More importantly, Lord, that you would help us to obey. So, God, go before us now. We wait with great anticipation what you're going to speak to us from and through your word today. Lord, fill us now with your Holy Spirit and bless us with your presence. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Let's all turn in our Bibles to the book of Revelation, chapter 20, as we continue our verse-by-verse study through Scripture. While you're turning, I just want to bring to your attention the fact that we had a very, very successful VBS this week. And I would personally like to thank all of those. We had many, many servants, all of those, Rachel and Joanna and Marcus and Chris and Charles and Kevin. And there's too many to name, but thank you guys for serving those kids this week. It was a tremendous success. In chapter 19... of Revelation, John was shown the second coming of Jesus and the fact that Jesus doesn't come back to earth at his second coming as that humble servant king destined to die on the cross at the hands of sinful man like he did at his first coming. Jesus at his second coming doesn't come riding on the foal of a donkey, comes riding on a white horse with the full authority of God and with the fullness of God's wrath upon sin. And we saw that with just one swipe of the sword, which is the word of God, Jesus was able to slaughter all those who had gathered at the Valley of Megiddo to fight against him. And the only two survivors of that battle, you'll remember, were Antichrist and the false prophet. But you'll remember they survived for a reason, because Jesus pronounced upon them a sentence that would bypass Hades, which is the holding place for people awaiting judgment. Jesus bypassed Hades for Antichrist and the false prophet. He just went ahead and sent them to their final eternal destination, which is Gehenna, or what you and I would call hell. And that brings us up to chapter 20. Now, you'll remember with the trumpet judgments, at the sounding of the fifth trumpet, there is a fallen angel that comes forth that had been given the key to the bottomless pit, or the abuso. And you remember how he opens up the bottomless pit for the purpose of releasing upon the earth these demonic locust-looking things that were to go out and to torment man for a period of 5 months during the tribulation period. But now as we move into chapter 20, we're going to have another angel that comes forth, only this is not a fallen angel. This time this is a true messenger of God, and he's going to come forth holding the same key to the same bottomless pit, and he's going to also open up the bottomless pit, only his purpose is not to let something out. His purpose is to put someone in, namely Satan, the dragon. God, already having dealt with Antichrist and the false prophet in this chapter, now he's going to specifically deal with Satan, the dragon. And this is going to be the chapter where he receives his final judgment and where we see the outcome in the final chapter on his on Satan's reign of terror upon this earth. And so the Lord has returned. The battle of Armageddon is over. And the millennial kingdom, the thousand-year reign of Jesus has now begun. And that's where we pick up our study here in verse 1 of chapter 20. Then I saw, John says, an angel coming down from heaven, having the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. We're told he laid hold of the dragon, that serpent of old, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. So first of all, what I want you to notice is that this angel who comes forth to apprehend Satan in order to incarcerate him, this isn't Jesus. This isn't Michael or Gabriel or any other high-ranking angel or cherubim. This is just an ordinary, nameless, anonymous angel that God sends. And so my point is when everything is said and done, whenever God declares the time, this Satan, this dragon, who you and I know as a roaring lion, who seeks, you know, whom he may devour, this roaring lion, when God declares it time, he's going to be completely defanged and declawed, and God's going to use just an ordinary angel to do it. And so contrary to popular belief, Satan is not God's opposite equal. Satan is not God's nemesis. Satan, or God, is not in, you know, a hard-fought battle against Satan and or evil. Satan is nothing to God in this world other than, you know, just a puppet on a string as God is leading to do his bidding and his will. Don't ever forget that Satan is a created being. He's created by God, and he's created just like the rest of us for God's purposes. And as we see here, God can very easily stop Satan's activity upon the earth anytime he chooses. And the only reason that God allows Satan to wreak havoc in the world, people will often question what kind of a loving God allows, you know, evil and allows Satan to do this or that. And the reason that God allows it is because somehow, beyond our human ability to be able to comprehend and understand, somehow all evil in the world contributes to God's will being done on the earth. Not that, certainly don't want to imply that God approves of Satan's deception or depravity, or that God approves of evil. Certainly he does not. Evil breaks God's heart. But God is God of everything, thankfully. And God is able to take every evil in this world and every evil that Satan perpetrates, and God is able to take it and to turn it into something that's eternally productive. And there's and listen, there's no greater example of that than the suffering and the death of Jesus. The devil, no doubt, thought he had won as the blood of Jesus was dripping off of those wooden beams of his cross, and this celebration, no doubt, broke out between the devil and his minions, thinking that they had won. But again, it backfires, because it turns out it was part of God's plan all along. And it was the one and only thing, the blood of Jesus, the blood of God himself, was the one and only thing that was going to necessitate forgiveness and salvation for a fallen, lost, hopeless world. And so, as the devil is celebrating the death of Jesus, you know, as back was laid open, you know, these ribbons of flesh that are dripping from his body, it turns out, the Bible says, by his stripes we are healed. Without his stripes, we would not be healed. We would not have salvation. And so the angel comes along with the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. He takes that chain and he uses it to bind the devil. And according to God's plan, as it says, Satan's going to remain bound for the entire millennial kingdom, for the entire 1,000-year reign of Christ on the earth. In verse 3, he, the angel, cast him, Satan, into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal on him so that he should deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years were finished. So first off, Satan was kicked out of heaven. Now he's finally kicked off of the earth. Only he's not put into Gehenna along with Antichrist and the false prophet at this time, because as we're going to see, God's got one more task for him to perform. So for now, he's chained and he's locked away in the abuso for the entire 1,000-year reign of Christ upon the earth. Now, sidebar, we're not given a lot of details in this chapter as it relates to what the millennial kingdom is going to look like, other than we're, you know, obviously it's going to be 1,000 years, And then, as we're told, Satan's going to be locked away for that entire period of time. We're told that. And then we're also told in a couple of verses how it's you and I, the church, how we will actually rule and reign with Christ during the thousand-year millennial reign. And that's basically about all we're told of the millennial characteristics of the millennium in this chapter. But there are plenty of other places in Scripture, and particularly the book of Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah, gives us many details and characteristics related to what the millennial kingdom is going to look like. And I thought it would be good to share, you know, a few of those characteristics with you this morning. Isaiah chapter 32, verses 16 through 18, speaks of how the rule of righteousness will bring about perfect peace and tranquility and safety upon the earth. Everybody's wanting peace, right? Especially in the Middle East right now. And everybody's got this plan how they're going to bring forth peace. Peace is not going to come until the Prince of Peace comes. And when he comes and he rules and reigns this world in and through righteousness, peace is going to be a direct result of righteousness and nothing else. So it says, then justice will dwell in the wilderness and righteousness remain in the fruitful field. And we're told here, the work of righteousness will be peace. And the effect of righteousness, quietness and assurance forever. How many people locked your doors when you left your house this morning? Probably most of us. But here we'll see in the millennial reign, there no longer be a need for deadbolt locks or any kind of locks whatsoever, because we'll dwell in safety. There'll be no need for police officers or no need for, you know, any sort of military. It says, my people will dwell in a peaceful habitation, in secure dwellings, and in quiet resting places. Isaiah 65 communicates how life expectancy in the millennial reign will revert back to pre-flood days, when people will live for hundreds and hundreds of years. And the Bible says that if you die at 100 years old, you'll die as like you're a child. Isaiah chapter 11, verses 6 through 9, speaks of how nature will be transformed back to its original pre-fall of man design, in that predatory animals, carnivores, will become herbivores. Wolves and lions and bears and cobras will become tame and domesticated. It says, the wolf also shall dwell with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the young goat, the calf and the young lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young ones shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play by the cobra's hole, and the weaned child shall put his hand in the viper's den, and they shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain. For the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Isaiah chapter 2, verses 2 through 5, speaks of how Jesus will rule and reign from the throne of David, from Jerusalem, and that the word of God will actually be something that the world desires. It speaks of how, again, there will be no more war, and finally, the fact that anti-Semitism will be something that no longer exists in the world, and thus the Jews will finally get to enjoy all of the blessings that was promised to them by God going all the way back to Abraham. It says, now it shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established on the top of the mountains. That's speaking of Jerusalem. And shall be exalted above the hills, and all nations shall flow to it. So the throne of Jesus will be established in Jerusalem, and all of the world will come to worship him there, and he will govern according to righteousness. It says, notice, many people shall come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways. Imagine that. The world now wants to be taught the word of God. And not just for the purpose of knowing it, but notice, actually living it. As it says, and we shall walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations and rebuke many people, and they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. And so all these military weapons, you know, that we'll no longer have a need for, can't waste all of that metal, so they're going to take it all and fashion it and turn it all into gardening tools. We're told nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. And I tell you what, no one benefits from that more today than the nation of Israel, who basically has been at war since its inception. And we're told here, O house of Jacob, come and let us walk in the light of the Lord. Ezekiel then speaks of how there will be the rebuilt temple in Jerusalem. Remember, 3.5 years into the tribulation period, Antichrist comes, he puts a stop to the worship of Yahweh, Jehovah God, that's been going on there. He puts a stop to the animal sacrifices and all. But that temple and all of the sacrifices will be reinstituted during the millennial reign. And it's going to be for the purpose of, you know, the same way, reason that we do communion today. It's like a memorial of what God has done for us in the past. And so the millennial reign will be a worldwide display of the glory and the peace and the authority of Jesus Christ. And as a result, all of nature will be freed from the bondage and the consequences of sin and evil. As I've said before, the millennial reign will be the answer to the Lord's Prayer, where we have prayed over and over and over for millennia, that God's will would be done finally on this earth, just as is done as it is done in heaven. And here in the millennial reign, we'll get the answer to that prayer, where God's will be done on this earth and righteousness will reign. But it says, after these things, after the millennial reign, we've just jumped in one verse, we've just jumped 1,000 years. All right, from the beginning of the millennial reign to the end, at the end of the millennial reign, it says, he, Satan, must be released for a little while. So at the close of the millennium, Satan's going to be released from the pit, and God is going to allow him to go throughout the entire world and gather up as many allies as would care to join him in one last revolt against God and God's people. And you might ask, why would God allow this? Well, here's the reason, I think. I think it's just one final proof. It's one final demonstration of God showing us just how desperately wicked the heart of man is. A lot of people today who associate themselves, they call themselves Christians, they associate themselves with Christianity, but they live in knowing and willful sin and don't seem to have a whole lot of conviction over it, because in their mind they have a built-in excuse. And their built-in excuse, they feel like that their sin is not a result of their own lack of commitment unto Jesus or their own lack of love for Jesus, as Jesus communicates. They believe that their sin is not a result of their own lack of self-control, but that it's because of circumstances that are beyond their control. In other words, people convince themselves that they are nothing more than products of some kind of an immoral environment that they were unwittingly subjected to and brought up in. So people will say, and this, if you do a whole lot of counseling, you'll hear a lot of times people will say, well, listen, I'm an alcoholic because my dad was an alcoholic or my mom was an alcoholic. It's just, you know, it's the way I grew up. It's what I know. Or, you know, I'm an angry, abusive person because I grew up in that kind of home or that kind of environment. So, you know, really, it's not my fault. I'm an adulterer. I'm a porn addict. I use, you know, profane language because that's what everybody around me does. It's just, you know, it's just part of my culture. And they see themselves as this victim of circumstance or product of an environment. And what God does here in the millennial kingdom is he gives the world 1,000 years of what is a perfect environment, 1,000 years of being governed by the righteousness of Jesus. And what is revealed at the end of it all is man's rebellion against God and man's propensity to be drawn towards the flesh is not in any way whatsoever associated with environment or circumstance. God shows us, whether it's today or at the end of the millennial reign of Christ, if you have knowing and willful sin in your life, you don't have an environment problem. You've got a heart problem. You're not a victim of circumstance. You're self-deceived. As always with sin, the heart of the problem is the problem of the heart. Because when you are truly saved, now you're not going to be perfect, obviously, but we're talking about a lifestyle of knowing and willful sin. When you are truly saved and your sins are thoroughly washed in the blood of Jesus, it produces a heart change. It can't not produce a heart change. It produces a supernatural transformation that is beyond explanation. The Bible says that when you are born again, that you become not only a new creation, but we're told that the old things, your past, your BC, everything who you were before Christ, including whatever negative environment you might have been brought up in, the Bible tells us that old things have passed away and that all things become new. How many things? All things become new. So if you're truly born again, everything about you, including your past and present environment, everything about you has been reconciled to God. That's 2 Corinthians chapter 5, by the way. So to continue to try to peddle the I'm just a product of my environment excuse for sin, to not be changed, to not have become a noticeably different kind of person in creation, think about that, what that might indicate. I'm not here to try to get anybody to doubt their salvation, but understand that the fruit you bear matters. It tells a lot about what kind of tree you are, obviously. And it's a very dangerous game that if you're associating with Christianity and you're continuing in a lifestyle of willful sin, because forgiveness of sin requires repentance. And you can never truly and fully repent of something which in your mind something or someone else bears any or all of the culpability. I can't truly repent of sin in my life when I believe that any part of that sin is someone else's fault. As Kay Smith always used to say, God can forgive anything, but God can't forgive excuses. And God makes sure in this chapter that no one is seduced into thinking that they're going to avoid an eternity in hell by just having some kind of a superficial faith in Jesus that hasn't resulted in some kind of a noticeable life change. Don't be seduced into thinking that you're going to avoid an eternity in hell because you have a legitimate excuse for sin. You don't. And God turns the devil loose after 1,000 years of this worldwide perfect environment just to prove that sin has never been an environment problem. It has always been a heart problem. Just imagine 1,000 years of peace reigning upon the earth, the lion and the lamb lying side by side, every man living under his own vine with no fear, as the prophet Micah prophesied. Imagine a child playing with a rattlesnake or a lion or a bear. Imagine 1,000 years of unparalleled peace and prosperity under the absolutely perfect government of Jesus Christ, but then finding out once Satan is released that there were those whose submission unto the Lord was only superficial. And once again, when given a choice, there will be those who choose to join Satan and to be drawn into rebelling against the government and the authority of Jesus. And the reason is because I said in earlier chapters, don't ever, ever underestimate the power of and the allurement of Satan, who disguises himself as an angel of light. Satan makes himself and his ways so appealing and so attractive that, as we saw in earlier chapters, he's able to convince even a third of the angels of heaven to rebel against God. What does that say as it relates to us? It tells us that we as human beings, if angels will rebel and follow Satan, you and I have no chance. I can tell you right now, anything short of a human being being fully surrendered to the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, there's not a single one of us that won't follow Satan to the ends of the earth. Because you don't have any power against him. You are incapable of standing against him, as am I. So that's why the Bible says, with men it is impossible. With God all things are possible. So it's God, it's Jesus, it's the Holy Spirit in you that will stand against the wiles of the enemy. Amen? And that's what's being demonstrated here at the end of the millennial reign, that these superficial surface believers, if you will, these are people they have never in their lifetime experienced evil. They don't know what evil even looks like. But as soon as evil and rebellion is loosed in the world, many of them are bewitched by it. And they're drawn to it like a moth to a flame. And John says here in verse 4, and I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was committed to them. So John sees the church as the judges of the earth. Didn't say that here, but obviously we know that all throughout Scripture. In Revelation chapter 3, verse 21, we're told, to him who overcomes, Jesus says, I will grant to sit with me on my throne. And I also, as I also overcame, sit down with my Father on his throne. So we will be judges with Jesus. We'll judge the earth and the people of the earth. And what we will judge, what we will enforce, is righteousness. And just not to confuse you, understand, you know, we will have already received our glorified bodies. You know, we've been in heaven with Jesus for 7 years. We return with him, as we saw in chapter 19. So when we come back to earth, rule and reign for the millennial kingdom, we'll still be in our glorified bodies. That is, if you're saved, you're going to be part of the rapture. But there will be people living on earth during the millennial reign who are still in their physical mortal bodies. These are the tribulation saints who survive the great tribulation. Remember how we were told at least a third of the Jews will survive and come out of the tribulation period. So there will be people who make the transition alive from the tribulation period into the millennial reign. And then, of course, these people will be married and given in marriage, and they'll raise up children and have families, and generations will be raised up after generations. And so you can imagine how much the earth will be populated very quickly over a 1,000-year period, not only of forced righteousness, but 1,000-year people where, you know, people live for hundreds and hundreds of years. But the point is all these people who are born, they're mortal people within physical bodies who are born in the millennial reign, they too will have to make the decision to be saved the same way that we are all saved, and that is by grace through faith in Jesus, and the kind of faith that results in a heart change, not a superficial faith. And though, again, they won't have the choice for 1,000 years, they won't have the choice outwardly. They will be made to live according to righteousness, but they will have to make the minute-by-minute choice, just like everybody else, to be governed by righteousness inwardly, that is, from the heart. And though man will not have to deal with the influence of Satan during that time, he will have to deal with his own human nature, which, as we're going to see, and we've already talked about, just the human nature in general is desperately wicked. There's nothing good in us apart from the grace of God. And so, again, the reason that there is a glorious time of peace and prosperity on earth during the 1,000 years is because the world is sternly governed by truth and righteousness, and not by, you know, by man, not by corrupt, slick politicians. And again, it's the church who will be appointed as the judges and the rulers of this world, and we'll be the one who is, you know, are the arbitrators of righteousness. Of course, the church being under the supreme authority of Jesus, who's ruling from the throne in Jerusalem. But again, the reason that righteousness prevails is not because everybody in the millennial kingdom is necessarily fully sold out to Jesus. There are going to be many who are not. And there are going to be many people who are just waiting for the opportunity to rebel against God, which God is going to provide for them that opportunity to their own detriment. Continuing in verse 4, John now specifically mentions the tribulation saints, those who died in the tribulation and were faithful to the Lord. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded or executed for their witness to Jesus and for the word of God, and had not worshipped the beast or his image, and had not received his mark on their foreheads or on their hands. And we're told, and they lived and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. And so you have the resurrected church. You also have the resurrected tribulation saints ruling and reigning with Christ in the millennium. And it says in verse 5, but the rest of the dead did not live again until the 1,000 years were finished. Now, the rest of the dead are all these people who have died having never accepted Jesus as their Lord. Again, they're in that holding cell, if you will. It's kind of like the difference between, you know, local jail as you're waiting, you know, your sentencing or whatever to go to prison. But we're told of what happens to these people at the end of this chapter and what God and what John calls the second resurrection. But for believers who die in Christ, we are raised up in what's called the first resurrection. As it says here, this is the first resurrection. What is the first resurrection? Well, one thing that you and I have, no matter where you come from, and no matter what color skin you have or culture or whatever, the one thing that we all have in common with our great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandfather, Adam, the one thing we all have in common with Adam is that everybody dies. We all die. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 22 says, for as in Adam, all die. That's the first death that's being spoken of here. That's the physical death. But thank God, in this same verse, there's a remedy that God has given to us as to not have to suffer the second death, which is spiritual death, the death of the soul, eternal death. And here's that remedy. Even so, in Christ, though you may die, all shall be made alive. And what that means is if you die in Christ, you may be put into that physical grave, but you're going to rise up out of that physical grave, and you're going to be raised up into eternal life. That's the first resurrection. However, if you die having never come to a saving faith in Jesus Christ, you will be raised up out of your physical grave as well. Only you'll be raised up not into eternal life, but into eternal death. That is the second resurrection. Jesus speaks of these two different resurrections in John chapter 5, verses 28 and 29. He says, do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in the graves will hear his voice and come forth, those who have done good, and good is accepting Jesus as your Savior, to the resurrection of life, those who have not accepted Jesus, those who have done evil, who still have their sins upon them, to the resurrection of condemnation. Now, it's important to note that the first resurrection, you know, all of the saints receiving their glorified bodies, this is not a singular one-time event or happening, but it is an order of events, if you will, that began with the resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ. We find this in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 20. It says, but now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep or those who have died. So Jesus has opened up the door for us to become part of the first resurrection, and thus he has delivered us from becoming part of this second resurrection, or what would result in this second death. And I know that's kind of throwing a lot at you, like maybe feels like taking a drink of water through a fire hydrant, but let me try to put this in layman's terms. It's just the reality is that every human being dies. According to the Bible, every human being will be raised up out of their graves. It's just that it's those in Christ who will be raised up into eternal life, and it's those who die outside of Christ will be raised up into eternal death. So in Christ, you live forever. Without Christ, you die forever. It's that simple. And it says in verse 6, blessed and holy is he who has part in the first resurrection. So what that tells me is if you are saved, this is a crazy, evil, wicked world we're living in right now. And as we get older and older, we all experience aches and pains, and we all, no matter, life is just full of bumps and bruises and tribulations, that's a promise. But no matter what you might be walking through in your life right now, I want you to know what's being communicated here is that from heaven's perspective, if you are saved, you are considered infinitely blessed. Because no matter what, you have eternal life. You are part of this first resurrection. Heaven is in your future, and it ain't going to be long. And so over the second death, we're told, spiritual death has no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ and shall reign with him 1,000 years. And the idea of the church, again, ruling and reigning with Christ during the millennial kingdom is something that's woven throughout all of the New Testament. 2 Timothy 2:12, Paul says, if we endure, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, however, he will also deny us. Verse 7, now when the 1,000 years have expired, Satan will be released from his prison and will go out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth. So Satan's going to be released. The first thing he's going to do, he's going to scour the entire planet, north, south, east, and west. We're told here Gog and Magog. The purpose is to gather them together to battle. And then very sadly, we're told whose number is as the sand of the sea. So Gog and Magog are mentioned because they've always been prophetic enemies of Israel. And they're big-time players, by the way, in the Ezekiel 38 war that we know is getting ready to happen. The sabers are rattling and the stage is being set for this war that we read about, Ezekiel 38-39. And what's interesting for us as the church is what kind of coincides with the Ezekiel 38 war, that something that happens either before the war or slightly after the war, sometime in there, is the rapture of the church. And so we know that the rapture has to happen before the tribulation. Gog and Magog have always been prophetic enemies of Israel, and they are big-time players in this war that's about to come up. But it's amazing to me that even after living in a perfect environment for 1,000 years, the people with no influence of Satan, no crime, no violence, no evil, no one with the excuse that they are a product of a bad environment, just perfect bliss. Yet, when man is given the opportunity, it's mind-boggling that not only will he turn his back on the Lord, but he'll join a coup or a rebellion orchestrated by Satan in an attempt to destroy God. It's mind-boggling. Again, this is talking about all of the billions of people who will have repopulated the planet Earth during the millennial kingdom. And though they all will have been governed by righteousness that whole time, at the end, God is going to give the people of the earth the opportunity to reflect and to live out what has really been going on in their hearts. It's going to be, an olive press kind of moment where people are, the obviousness of where a person stands inside is going to be revealed to the entire world. And all of those who would choose evil over good and rebellion over obedience, if they were allowed to, God's going to give them the green light to do so. God's going to say, go for it. They're at the end. These people haven't been able to choose evil for 1,000 years. They haven't been able to choose an allegiance to Satan over God for 1,000 years. They haven't been able to give in to the desires and the lusts of the flesh for 1,000 years. But given the first opportunity, we see here that many will. Many will choose to rebel against God, and many will choose to follow Satan. So many that John says they are as of the sand of the sea, meaning there's just too many to count. And so it just goes to show you how, people want to be religious, or they want to have this, you know, this strict interpretation of the law, believing that it's the law that saves you. The law can't save anybody. You see here, you can police the law, but the law can never change a heart. You can put a man in a perfect environment, but even a perfect environment will never produce a perfect heart. And so Satan has gathered this mighty army from the four corners of the earth. And it says they went up on the breadth of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints in the beloved city. So this rebellion now, they've marched into Jerusalem. They've got Jerusalem surrounded. And their strategy is not only they're going to try to destroy God's people, but they're also going to try to destroy God's holy city and God's temple and, you know, God's headquarters, basically. But even before a fire can be shot, even before the battle begins, notice it says, and fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. So imagine, you know, millions and millions of people converging there on Jerusalem, and they've got the whole place surrounded, and they think, boy, we got God right where we want him now, and just God's like, and that's it. Like, the whole insurrection is over in less than a second. They're all devoured by fire that comes down from heaven. And then verse 10, we see the devil gets his due. The devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone where the beast and the false prophet are. And notice here, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. And so Satan has now fulfilled God's purpose for him in this world. And so he's cast into his final destination, into hell. And what I want you to notice here is that we don't read about Satan hosting a big keg party with an open bar and, you know, and everybody down there rocking out to satanic music. What do we see? We see Satan here. But that, isn't that what most people think, though? That hell is going to be this big party? But it's not. And hell, everybody thinks that Satan is the ruler of hell. Satan's not the ruler of hell. He's a victim of hell. He's going to suffer the consequences of his actions along with everybody else that's there. And he's going to suffer for all of eternity along with everyone else. That was the reason that hell was created in the first place. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 25 that hell was not made for man. That hell was made for the devil and his angels, his minions. And then 2 Peter communicates how God is not willing that any person should ever end up there. In fact, God demonstrated that he'd rather come and die himself than for one of his people, one of his human beings that he created, that he loves, to ever end up there. And that's exactly what he did. He came and he gave his life in order that we could avoid this horrible place. Continuing on, John has shown the judgment of all those throughout history who rejected Christ. He says, then I saw a great white throne. Great, referring to its status, its power and authority. White, signifying its purity and holiness. And then obviously throne, speaking of the sovereignty of not just a king, but the great judge of all the earth. And understand that the great white throne judgment, people think that they're going to be able to go there and they're going to be there and they're going to plead their case before God. The problem is that the great white throne judgment is not a trial. The trial happened while everyone was still alive. And what established everyone's guilt or innocence was based on what they did with the truth as it relates to Jesus. So the great white throne judgment is not a trial, it's a sentencing. It's a sentencing of people who have chosen to they themselves suffer their own consequences for sin. No one at the great white throne judgment will be afforded the opportunity to plead their case because their case has already been settled. And it was settled as a result of them dying, having never accepted Jesus. So the great white throne judgment is a sentencing hearing. John says, I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. In other words, there will be no place in heaven or on earth for anyone to flee to once they have been brought before the judgment seat of Christ, before the great white throne judgment, I should say. No place for sinners to hide. It's you know, when it's time to face the judge, it's time to face the judge. And there'll be nowhere for you to go. Again, this is not the church. This is not for saved, born-again believers. We will stand before the Lord in heaven at what's called the Bema Seat of Christ, and that is, you know, that is a rewards ceremony. This is judgment, it's not the church. We don't have to face God's judgment because we've already been judged. Our judgment and our punishment, we didn't get away with anything. It's just the consequences of our sin was poured out upon the shoulders of Jesus when he was on the cross. So he suffered all of our consequences and all of our punishment for sin. But without him, without Jesus, each person is going to be held accountable for their own sin. And we notice here, God's been keeping track of all of them, all of the sin. And John says, "And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened." Now, as humans, again, we all have a BC. We all have a time, you know, when we were living according to the flesh. And we can remember the big things, right? I remember the big sins. But we certainly don't have the capacity to remember everything that we've ever said and done that missed the mark. But guess what? God does. And he's got it all written down in books. He's got it all written down in volumes. You know, think of every lie, every word of gossip, every feeling of envy, every profane gesture that ever came out of our mouths, every drunken stupor, every lustful thought. And listen, by the time that God is finished revealing all that is written in these books, I think only then will man fully grasp the weight and the enormity of sin that was present in his or her life on the earth. And when the books are opened and all of the nastiness and the wickedness of their heart is revealed, there won't be one man or woman who will be able to utter the words, you know, "I was a good person," or "I lived a pretty good moral life when I was on the earth," because everything that is recorded in those books is going to prove otherwise. And what's going to become so painfully obvious to everyone at that time is, because now you recognize the enormity of your sin, probably for the first time ever, you're also going to recognize that just how egregious your rejection of Jesus was. You couple those two things together, not only are you going to realize that hell is in your immediate future, but you're going to realize that you deserve it. I don't know many people that you could walk around just in the public and say, "Do you deserve hell?" Most people would say, "No, I don't think so. I'm pretty good." But it's not going to be the case on Judgment Day for the two reasons I just told you. And continue on, John says, "And another book was opened, which is the book of life." What that means is when you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, your name is written in this book in heaven called the book of life. And so here is Jesus with these, you know, sinners who never accepted him. He opens up the book of life and he reveals to them that their name is not written in there. So now it's not so much about all of this sin that he has just revealed to you and the enormity of your sin, but what's going to become obvious to you then is all of that sin, no matter how big and no matter how bad it was, it all could have been erased. It all could have been wiped completely clean if you had just had your name written in this other book called the Book of Life. And you do that by giving your heart and life to Jesus. But instead, here you are, standing before a holy God now based on your own merit and your own righteousness and your own goodness, which has already been revealed to you as infinitely and desperately deficient. And so with their names not written in the book of life, it says, finishing out verse 12, "The dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books." The books won't lie. They won't leave out even the most minor details related to your sin. And that is the fate that you're choosing for yourself if you die having never made Jesus the Lord of your life. The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them. It doesn't matter who you are or how you died, whatever happened to your body, if you were put in a grave or if you were lost at sea or whatever, everyone, every dead person will be raised up into judgment. And it says they were judged, each one according to his works. And then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. Those are the last vestiges of sin. They're now eliminated, thankfully, from existence. Death is the result of sin, and now it's gone. Hades is a result of death, and now it's gone. Both cast into the lake of fire. And so the dominion of sin is no more. And finishing out verse 14, it says, this is the second death. Alfred, in his commentary, says there is, just as there is a second higher degree of life, there is a second deeper degree of death. In other words, hell is just as real as heaven. And to the same degree of bliss and beauty and all of these positive superlatives you could think of related to heaven, you have the exact opposite that's true of hell. And as with the second life, you're born again, there is no more death. But with the second death, there is no more life. And John closes out this chapter in verse 15, and anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. A lot of people today will tell you, even here in pulpits, that man, hell's not a real place. But Jesus taught twice as much on hell as he did heaven. And what I want to close with this. I want to just kind of iterate to you how hell is a witness to three things. First off, hell speaks of the righteous character of God and the fact that God must thoroughly judge sin in order to remain holy and perfect and good. Secondly, hell is a witness to human responsibility, meaning people, God didn't create people just to be robots. He didn't create us to just see ourselves as helpless victims in all of this. We recognize that heaven is real. We recognize that hell is real. We must also recognize that we have a choice between the two. We are creatures who are created with the ability to make our own choices. And so what that means is that anyone who ends up in hell, they won't be there because some mean God sent them there. They'll be there because they chose to be there. And then finally, thirdly, hell is a testimony of the awfulness of sin. Truly, if you and I were given just a small glimpse of sin through the eyes of God, if we were in any way able to see sin from God's perspective, I think we would all understand why a place like hell has to exist. We would also understand why it is absolute lunacy for anyone not to make the arrangements as to avoid that awful place, to avoid that second death. Again, everyone is born physically. But Jesus said it's he who is born again, born a second time, born of the Spirit, that's he or she who is saved. So, as the saying goes, if you're born only once, you die twice. If you're born twice, you die once. And that second birth, again, is what gets your name recorded in that Lamb's Book of Life. And it gets all of the sin that's recorded in all those other books erased and completely wiped clean. And so as you read chapter 20, it's a difficult chapter. What we should all be pondering, anyone who reads this chapter and understands it, what we should be pondering in our hearts, you know, number one, have I surrendered my heart and life to Jesus? Have I been born again? Is my name written in the book of life? Have all of the volumes and all the books of my sin been erased and wiped clean? Will I be part of the first resurrection or the second resurrection? I have a choice. There's a future. for me that exists of one of two places. Either heaven is in my future or the lake of fire. We each have a choice. I'm out of time here, but if you have never settled that issue of lordship in your heart, I want to invite you to come up after service and just see me, and let's talk about it. I'll pray with you, whatever. If you got questions, come up. Don't leave here having never settled this issue of what is in your future. Okay? Let's pray. Father, we pause here for a moment just to recognize the enormity of this decision that you've put before each of us. And may you bring conviction where conviction is necessary, Lord. May no one that's in this room or watching online become comfortable or complacent in their sin or in any kind of rebellion against you. And may there not be one, Lord, who hasn't settled this issue of lordship, giving you the reins to their heart and life. And if they haven't, and if they continue to choose not to, Lord, that they would at least know the outcome, and they would know that what's in store for them is something that they have chosen. And so, Father, fill us with your Holy Spirit. Continue to give us the ability to walk out your truth and your light. Thank you for this difficult chapter. Thank you for your truth. And thank you, Lord, for not pulling any punches as it relates to your character and your heart and your expectation. Thank you for saving us. Thank you for giving us the power to live like we're saved. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you all. Have a blessed and glorious week. I pray that God just speaks to you and just draws himself close to you as you seek to walk out his word and to be a shining example of his truth in this world. Let's all stand and we'll close. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. Love you all. God bless you.
That's how you change the world.
Thank you for listening to Change the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Somerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ.